Dear Cole, our warmest mazel tov to you on this day. You make us all very, very proud, and you should be too. You led us so beautifully and taught us so eloquently in what has been a challenging year for the Jewish community. You offer us a brilliant ray of light and hope, and we are so grateful, as we are for our guest speaker this morning, Rabbi David Wolpe. Visiting scholar at Harvard Divinity School, Max Webb, Emeritus Rabbi at Sinai Temple in Los Angeles, and inaugural Rabbinic Fellow for the Anti-Defamation League, Rabbi Wolpe was named the most influential rabbi in America by Newsweek and one of the 50 most influential Jews by the Jerusalem Post. He has taught at the Jewish Theological Seminary, the American Jewish University, Hunter College, and UCLA. He wrote a weekly column in the New York Jewish Week for almost 25 years, a weekly Torah column for the Jerusalem Post, and is the author of 8 books, including the national bestseller, Making Loss Matter. Rabbi Wolpe has been published and profiled in dozens of magazines and newspapers, has been featured on every major television network, and is a speaker much in demand around the world. But no synagogue, save Sinai Temple in Los Angeles, can claim him as its own these days more than Temple Emanu-El, because Rabbi Wolpe has helped us envision and then led some of the most exciting Jewish adult education programming offered anywhere today. I am personally so grateful for his commitment to our temple and for honoring us with his presence this morning. In anticipation of Shavuot, the festival celebrating the giving of the Ten Commandments and Torah at Mount Sinai, his theme today will be How the Ten Commandments Matter Today. Please welcome truly one of the Gedolei Hador, the most consequential Jewish leaders of our time, Rabbi David Wolpe.
I want to thank Rabbi Davidson, first of all, for the beautiful introduction, and Cole, thank you for allowing me to share your bar mitzvah with you. When Rabbi Davidson was kind enough to ask me if I would speak about the Ten Commandments, you know, this is like asking a singer, will they do the scales, or a classical actor, will they do a soliloquy from Shakespeare? Every rabbi's got his Ten Commandment riff. In fact, you can stop a rabbi on the street, say, quick, give me your Ten Commandments. But that is not necessarily true for all of you. And I remember, actually, when he asked, one of the things that struck me was years ago, I saw this movie where Burt Reynolds was starring, and he had decided he was going to commit suicide, and he swims out to sea. And then when he gets far out, he decides, no, this is a bad idea. I have to swim back. And he looks up at the heavens, and he says, God, if you give me the strength to swim back, I will observe the Ten Commandments. I won't kill, I won't steal. Then he stops for a minute, he goes, I will learn the Ten Commandments. And I think that that's probably true for a lot of us. And rather than give you all the Ten Commandments, I want to make 2 points about them, just that. One theological and one interpersonal. If you ever studied the ancient world, paganism, if you read Homer, if you read the Greeks, if you ever did Roman history or you read books about Rome, you will discover something about the gods. Not just that they're immature, which they are, but also that all the gods care about is how you treat them. You sacrifice to them, they're happy, you will do well. You irritate them, you will do badly. The one thing that the gods of the ancient world don't care about is how people treat each other. The greatest innovation of the Ten Commandments was it started the same way as the ancient world. I'm the Lord your God. I don't want any other gods in front of me. You should only care about me as God. But then it goes on to say, I care about how you treat your parents. I care about how you treat your neighbor. I care about how you treat your neighbor's possessions. In other words, the great innovation of Judaism was exactly what Cole said in his bar mitzvah speech. It was about community, not only about your relationship to God. And that's the theological point that is central to the innovation of the Ten Commandments in the world. But then I want to take the most problematic commandment and say something about us. All the commandments are belief and behavior, right? You should have one God, you shouldn't do terrible things, and then you get to the last commandment. I'm tempted to give a snap quiz. Anybody remember what the last commandment is? Excellent. You shouldn't covet. And then it goes on to all these things that you shouldn't covet. And the rabbis have a hard time with this because how can you tell people not to feel things? How can you tell people not to walk down the street and see somebody wearing something beautiful or have driving a car that you want or living in a home that you'd like and make it a sin to want that? And so I want to tell you another way to think about that commandment. Not the only other way, because usually what most of the commentators say is it doesn't so much mean that you can't feel it, you just can't act on it, you can't try to take it from someone else. But that isn't exactly what the commandment says. It says don't covet. In Hebrew, the Ten Commandments, and this may be a shock to you, are not called the Ten Commandments. They're called Aseret HaDivarim, or Aseret HaDibrot, which literally translates to the Ten Sayings, not the Ten Commandments. So think of it for a moment as a saying instead of a commandment. So a rabbi of the 19th century said, when it says, thou shalt not covet, what it means is, if you do these commandments, if you live this way, you won't covet. You'll live in gratitude and not in grievance. You'll live being satisfied with what you have instead of constantly saying, you didn't give me enough. You will feel as though you are blessed instead of feeling as though you've been cheated. And one of the things that we know, all of us, who after all constitute like the 99.9% luckiest human beings who have ever lived, right? If you live with indoor plumbing, that already bumps you up to like 70%, and dentistry puts you in 80%, and antibiotics puts you in 90%, you know, and cable news puts you back down. But you understand how much luckier we are than almost all of our ancestors, and yet we still feel like we've been treated unfairly. Because it's not a function of your circumstance, it's a function of your soul. It's really not about how the world has treated you. It's much, much more about how you understand what it is that you deserve in this world. And the truth is, most of us get much, much, much more than we deserve. Which doesn't, by the way, mean that we shouldn't feel grateful for it. But we should also feel responsible for it. It is our task then to make sure that others have what we have because we're so lucky. And instead of thinking constantly about the things we didn't get that we should have gotten, think about all the things that we've been given that we didn't earn, that we live in buildings we didn't build, drive cars we didn't create, have air conditioning we didn't invent, benefit from medicines we didn't create. We are extravagantly blessed. That's what the last commandment really means. The last commandment can be read as, remember you are lucky and remember you are blessed and feel grateful for that blessing. And it's not true that you won't have moments where you won't feel it, but baseline, it's important to remember how lucky we are, how blessed we are, and that is the basis for all of the commandments. Because gratitude is, after all, what you heard all morning in our prayers and in our words. Gratitude for family, for community, and for all the many blessings that shower down upon us. And if you don't feel it sometimes, then I'll just conclude with this story. The seer of Lublin was a great Hasidic leader. And when he was a little kid, he used to wander off into the forest. And one day his father pulled him aside, because his father liked to be, I suppose, a liberal father, but, you know, a kid in the forest, not such a great idea. So he said to him, "My child, I see that you wander off in the forest. I'm a little bit worried about you. Why are you doing that?" And he said, "Well, I go there to find God." And his father said, "Oh, that's beautiful, but don't you know that God is the same everywhere?" And he said, "Yeah, God is, but I'm not." All of us can find places in our lives where we can feel that gratitude. The first words that a Jew is supposed to speak in the morning are "Mode ani lefanecha," I am grateful to you. So just remember, next time you find that space, that moment, where you feel grateful, you're just following the Ten Commandments. Shabbat Shalom.